All right. So, Stevie, I was going over, you know, I was going over 2023's big economic themes through our monthly segment. We followed them very closely. I mean, we started January with the airport glitch. I think we have a wrap of this, inflation, and then you've got the president's travels and the criticism that came with those travels. We brought in your friend Nori at one point of Navigar and talked about patient capital, Metro Pacific's delisting, succession planning in the LT Group. We also spent a number of episodes on the controversial Maharlika Investment Fund, the rice price cap, and even the military pension. What a year it's been. I wonder, and I want to start with this, how would you grade or assess the economic year that was?
Good and bad. The good part is we're aware of the issues. I mean, I think no one can accuse this administration and our economic managers of being unaware or in denial. So at least they're aware of what are the pressing issues, you know, fiscal balance, economic growth, agriculture, inflation, food prices. So they know what they're talking. I mean, they are aware and concentrating on the main issues, not sideshows. The bad is, I think, the execution has not been ideal because the results have not been ideal. So awareness is there. Execution is mixed, to be polite. So, like, military pension. As someone who had maybe a little more sensitivity to total nuances rather than a just plus and minus numbers view of things would have realized the initial proposal was frankly not going to happen. And what ended up happening, which was passed by the Senate, what I suggested and many others suggested, because it wasn't an original thought, it was history of what happened in similar situations in the West, similar situations in Australia, which is you divide the pension into two. You respect the deal you cut with the employees in place, and you reform going forward. They called it superannuation in Australia. They called it two-tier pension plans in the US. But in the end, that is what happened. Mm-hmm. That could have been done if first he had consulted people ahead of time rather than publicly said, our fiscal house is about to collapse. And frankly, he wasn't crying wolf. It is a serious problem. But it could have been done a little more quietly, a little more cooperatively, and then sort of cut a deal without inflaming certain sectors. Mm-hmm. And in the end, there is also the aspect of fairness. And a contract is a contract. And in the end, that's where we landed. Mm-hmm. We're respecting the contracts and the pensions we signed with existing personnel, and we're changing it for new ones.
All right.
I mean, if we were going to land there, there would have been a much nicer way of getting there.
Nicer landing. Stevie, you mentioned he several times when you answered the first question. I imagine you're referring to the singular personality that ties all of these stories together, except for the corporate developments, the macro stuff. Finance Secretary Benjamin Jokno, who is leading the president's economic team.
Yes.
There's a lot of talk swirling around circles about a possible exit, just rumors for now. We don't want to speculate, but from an investment banker's perspective, I guess we want to ask you what qualities, you know, and just as important, what circumstances do you think make a good finance secretary?
I'm glad you asked it both ways, because there is no one correct answer and there is no wrong answer. Because, you know, if I read the sort of, let's just say, biased columnists in the press, you have either people saying we need someone with political savvy and the other people saying you can't give it except to a technocrat. The answer is there's three models for finance secretaries. One is someone from the private sector or business, like an ex-banker or a CEO, CFO type. The other one is the what I call the bureaucrat academic background. Cesar Virata was the best example of that, and no one thinks he did a bad job. And the third is a politician. Now, all three are equally valid. in some cases, one of the models might be more attuned than the others. Now, when would that, for example, what did, and let me be very honest, most of our non-politician finance secretaries do? They borrowed money and maybe they sold assets. It's very contentious in our very rambunctious democracy to actually do tax reform and raise revenue. If you ask me who were the two who did it, one was obviously the person I consider probably overall the best finance secretary we've had in my adult life, which is Sonny Dominguez. Look at Train. Train and the additional tax reforms did three things. They lowered tax rate, increased compliance, and increased revenue. On top, it became also a little more equal and less skewed. And that took someone who had a combination of political skills, having been in government previously, private sector savvy, being a businessman. And so he was able to do both. Another guy who successfully helped implement together with the president, who was probably the super finance secretary at the time, Gloria Macapagal-Arroyo, because she's a PhD in economics and had political sense. They did the VAT reform, which brought the peso back from 58 to below 50, ameliorated the effect of oil price increases at the time and so on. So if you look at the time when major tax laws were implemented, passed and implemented, they were done under, finance secretaries with political backgrounds. Now, at a time when macroeconomics were stable and you wanted to ride the wave well, someone who knew how to borrow money, how to privatize assets, how to do things, we had other finance secretaries who were not of political background who were successful doing that. But what I think is key, regardless of the model you use, besides what are the times and the circumstances, as you're correctly pointed out, is does the guy have sensitivity to the fact that in government, financial issues are not limited to finance? Appreciating not just finance and economics, but the social and political ramifications are, for me, equally important. You have to be savvy to that because it is reality. You are not budgeting for a company who's trying to increase market share or profits. You are running a country's finances and economics. And there are multiple constituencies of equal value you have to attend to. That's my view.
Stevie, you mentioned earlier the super finance person at GMA during that time was also the time when Ralph Recto was also in the limelight. He did work on that, and it's his name that's being floated as maybe a potential for a finance minister. Are your thoughts on this? I mean, I know it's wrong to be asking. Go ahead.
Okay, I've never met him, but from what I see, he's qualified and he would fit the model of, I would say, the successful politician finance secretary. Now, I wouldn't call Sonny Dominguez a politician. He was just prior in government, but he was never in elective office. But you look at Gary Tevez and Bert Romulo, they were successful finance secretaries because they understood the broader dynamic as President Macapagal-Arroyo did and as Secretary Dominguez did, that are behind and inherent to crafting economic and finance policy and implementing it. So do I think he could be a very effective finance secretary? Yes, he has the ingredients to do it. Now, I've never met him, so I'm not, again, I've given enough people like to speculate. I'd rather err on the side of facts, track record, you know,
I have
what has been seen, rather than say, oh, I think he'll do this or I think he'll do that.
But Stevie, I have a feeling you're going to meet him soon. Another kind of shakeup that's been in the news lately in the corporate side is telco giant PLDT. President and CEO Alpan Lilio is retiring end of this year. Back at the helm is Chairman MVP, just after 2 years, after stepping down. What's sort of signaling this sent to investors? Is this a troubling signal?
Well, I mean, it's not good, but it's not bad necessarily. Because if you look at it, it seems to be a friendly resignation. Because an unfriendly resignation is get off my board, get off everything else, and lose, and I'll not change the key in your office. It doesn't seem to be that way, all right? So, and it's relatively friendly. Now, however, again, not entering into speculation, although I know both of them. I've not spoken to them in a while, so I don't know the background behind it. But I think there's, in a company that has a very dominant leader, whether it's a family-owned company or something which has a long-standing person like Manny Pangilinan there, you basically have two models. You have the CEO, you have in effect what I call the leader for life and the leader for a fixed term. Now, and I'm not saying you have to use one model or the other. In the Western world, the more common model is the leader for a fixed term. They basically tell the guy, it used to be retire at 60 or 65. Now more or less they're pushing it to 70. But you want the leader for life? Warren Buffett and Charlie Munger, you cannot argue with the results. Okay? They're leaders for life. Now, but most are leaders for a term. But here's the problem with a leader for life. If you're a very qualified potential successor, how long are you going to wait? And you will be tempted to go somewhere else or to say, you know, I've done enough. So I'm not saying they should change their leader for life. Manny Pangilinan has said he's going to do this as long as he can, and he has zero plans to retire. But if we accept that as the premise, then we also have to accept that these type of things will not be unusual because somebody who, like for example, in investment banking, why do you see very rare, like I was shocked that I lasted into my 60s because most are told, even if they like you, to move on in their 40s and at worst their 50s. It's just that Evercore is a very different firm that like old people. But generally, even if they like you, they ask you to move on because you've got to make space for other people. Otherwise, those people won't leave. It's like when Shaq and Kobe couldn't get along anymore, they chose Kobe because Kobe was younger than Shaq.
All right. Stevie, as always, never enough time. We're going to leave it at that cliffhanger on leaders for life and leaders for a fixed term. Thank you so much for the time, Stevie. We will see you again in the next month's edition of Stevenomics. Happy holidays from Market Edge.
Maybe I should come over in person in January.
You should.
Let's set that up. Traffic won't be that bad if it's the first week.
Yes, let's set that up. Thank you again, Stevie. See you soon.
All right. Happy holidays to everyone. Bye.